Many acres of American land suffer from one of two moisture problems. Either the soil is too wet or the soil is too dry. With proper treatment, however, some of these acres become productive cropland, popular golf courses, and even attractive wetlands. These important moisture management tools, artificial drainage and irrigation, have made some lands highly productive. On the other hand, they have also been the root of some ecological problems. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video describes artificial drainage with some of its problems. Drainage refers to how rapidly excess water leaves soil by runoff or draining through the soil. In a well-drained soil, excess water leaves the root zone quickly enough that roots do not suffer lack of oxygen. Poorly drained or wet soils remain waterlogged long enough to interfere with plant growth. Three conditions contribute to soil wetness. First, soils may be wet because they are naturally impermeable, like a compacted clay soil. Second, soil may be inundated by flooding or runoff from higher elevations. The third and most common cause of soil wetness is a high water table, the upper surface of a zone of saturation in the soil. Commonly, there are major regional water tables at some depth. There may also be shallower local water tables that form above an impermeable soil layer that restricts deeper percolation. These are called perched water tables because they are perched above the regional water table. Extending above the water table is a wet, nearly saturated zone created by capillary rise called the capillary fringe. The height of the fringe varies from about 6 inches in sand to about 18 inches in fine textured soil. Most drainage problems occur in depressions or large level areas that water cannot quickly exit by runoff. Parts of slopes may be wet where a ground layer intersects the land surface. Water leaks out into the soil at these locations called seeps. Where the water table or capillary fringe intrudes into the root zone, soil wetness can create anaerobic conditions that deprive roots of oxygen. For most plants, rapidly growing points such as root tips and root hairs are quickly damaged, and root rotting organisms attack the roots. Water and nutrient absorption suffers, and toxic minerals build up in the soil. Rooting will be limited to the aerated zone above the fringe. Thus, soil wetness limits the growth of upland crops such as corn and apple trees, and most common landscape plants. Poor drainage interferes with tillage and other growing operations like harvesting nursery stock. Poorly drained soil tends to stay wet later into the spring, delaying planting operations. Slow drying on poorly drained soils also keeps growers out of fields or nurseries after a rain. Because wet soils warm slowly, they stay cold later into the season and delay planting and seed emergence. Draining these soils lengthens the effective growing season. In arid and semi-arid areas, poor drainage can cause accumulation of salts in the root zone, leading to crop damage and increased susceptibility to erosion. Poor drainage also frequently interferes with success in managed landscape settings. As a consequence of their importance, federal and state programs offer protection to wetlands, and losses have slowed over the past decades. Wetlands are defined as areas that are flooded or saturated by surface or groundwater often enough and long enough during the growing season to support vegetation adapted for life in saturated soils. This condition is currently indicated by three criteria. Wetlands possess hydric soils, defined as soils that are saturated, flooded, or ponded long enough during the growing season to develop anaerobic conditions in the upper part. Wetlands exhibit wetland hydrology. That is, the amount and behavior of water in the soil is such that the surface soil is saturated enough during the growing season to warrant the designation of wetland determined by actual measurement. Wetlands host identifiable wetland vegetation. Soils meeting these criteria are legal wetlands and gain certain protections. Wetlands play an important role in water cycles of the United States. Many wetlands are sites for the recharge of groundwater. Wetlands also store water during snowmelt or heavy rains, reducing the amount of flooding by buffering rivers from an immediate influx of water. When wetlands are replaced by drain fields or suburban streets, large amounts of water enter rivers quickly rather than being held in wetland reservoirs. Both large permanent wetlands and small seasonal wetlands contribute to flood reduction. Wetlands play a role in improving water quality by trapping and filtering nutrients, sediments, and pollutants. Marsh plants absorb nutrients and even toxic chemicals. Peat on the marsh floor also absorbs pollutants, and high bacterial populations denitrify and remove nitrogen contamination. Thus, wetlands help reduce nutrient and chemical runoff from farms and nurseries. Restored or wholly created wetlands are increasingly being used to cleanse runoff from farm fields. water discharge into urban lakes, or even as an alternative to septic systems. Wetlands function as wildlife habitat. Even small seasonal temporary wetlands are important to many species of waterfowl during spring migration. Hundreds of other non-game animals depend on wetlands for food, protective cover, or sites to raise young. More than 50% of threatened or endangered species are associated in some way with wetlands. In addition, wetlands provide spawning areas for many fish and shellfish, particularly coastal marshes that host commercially important species. Wetlands also provide recreational and educational opportunities. Much hunting and fishing depends on wetland habitat, either directly or as nursery habitat for game or game fish. Science classes often visit wetlands for study. Pollen embedded in peat layers on the marsh floor is studied to recreate past climatic and vegetative conditions. Wet soils have fewer ecological functions compared with wetlands. Nearly 25% of all farmland would be too wet to support full production if they were not drained. The most apparent sign of poor drainage is the presence of standing water several days after a rain. Water-loving plants are often found growing on wet soil. A percolation test serves to infer drainage. In the test, holes are dug and filled with water to wet the soil around the hole. After emptying, the holes are refilled with water, and the time it takes for drainage is noted. Soils are divided into 7 drainage classes. These classes range from the driest, excessively drained, from which water is removed very rapidly, to the wettest, very poorly drained, in which water leaves the soil so slowly that surface water is wet during long periods of the growing season. Soil colors can be good indicators. In general, soils of uniform color of high value in chroma are well drained, while mottling and low value in low chroma colors indicate poor drainage. Soils classified as very poorly drained and many of those that are poorly drained meet the criteria for legal wetland and are best preserved as wetlands. Poorly drained soil must be treated for most crops, and even somewhat poorly drained soils often require treatment for best results. These soils at the dry end, on the other hand, benefit from irrigation. Soils that stay saturated can be artificially drained. Artificially drained soils can be remarkably productive, as they are in much of the Corn Belt. Surface drainage systems collect and remove excess water from the soil surface. Surface drainage is best suited to 3 conditions: collecting excess surface water on impermeable soil that cannot absorb it readily, channeling away water flooding fields from higher elevations, and collecting irrigation water applied in excess of the soil's ability to absorb it, although such application is itself a poor practice. Surface systems are inexpensive to install because they are simply ditches dug through the field. Water flows off the land into the ditch and is discharged off the field. In large, uniformly wet fields, a series of parallel ditches collects water from the whole area. Some grading may be done to improve the slope of the field to ensure that the water runs into the ditches. The primary function of surface systems is to remove surface water. However, they can also lower the water table in permeable soil if the ditches are dug deep enough to enter the water table. Subsurface drainage collects water that is seeped into the soil and discharges it into surface ditches. A subsurface system consists of buried pipes into which water seeps and then flows to an outlet. Water will not be released into a drain unless the surrounding soil is saturated, when matrix potential goes to zero. Drains are therefore installed below the water table in the zone of saturated material. By removal of excess water, drains lower the water table, leaving a deeper surface layer of drained soil. Previously, drains were made of clay or concrete, but perforated plastic pipe largely replaces tiles in subsurface drainage systems. The design of subsurface drainage systems depends on the situation. Small, poorly drained areas can be drained with a targeted system, while large areas will be served by a definite pattern. Soil texture determines depth and spacing. Coarser textured soils with better hydraulic conductivity allow wider spacings and deeper placement. A gentle grade in the tile line allows water to flow toward a collection main and onto an outlet, usually a drainage ditch. From there, the water flows towards some body of surface water, often a river, and is carried on to the sea. Where a grade is not feasible, water will be pumped for removal. While drainage systems enable us to farm some of our most productive soils, the accelerated water cycling on land creates environmental problems. It can, for instance, contribute to increased flooding by moving water rapidly off fields into rivers, causing a rapid increase in stream flow. Artificial drainage degrades water quality by transporting contaminants through ditch systems and into rivers. In many areas, drainage water carries nitrates from fertilization and manure application. No doubt the tile outlet in the top photo is dumping not only water, but also nitrates and some phosphorus into the ditch. Contaminants end up downstream where they cause water quality and environmental problems. For instance, a large dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico has been attributed partially to drainage systems in the Mississippi River Basin. Nitrate loading is the most severe when drainage is the most intense. That is, tile lines are deep, creating a deeper aerated zone, spaced close together, and run all the time. Nitrate loading can be minimized by installing or altering systems to drain less intensely through controlled drainage. Controlled drainage systems shut down or adjust the outflow of drainage water during times of the year when the water table can be allowed to rise. Also, they can reduce overdrainage or lowering the water table too much during dry spells. Controlled drainage reduces the pollutant load because less total water is conducted out of the field in a year, and when soil is wetter, bacteria denitrify more nitrates to nitrogen gas before they leave the field. Allowing the water table to rise at times also allows water to be stored for crops and can be used to slow subsistence of organic soils by reducing oxidation. Generally, controlled drainage involves gates that control outflow. By controlling outflow, the water table can be adjusted and allowed to rise during non-cropping periods or even as a form of sub-irrigation during dry periods. In practice, the pollution load can be reduced an average of 30% with no loss or even a gain of productivity. The actual design of controlled drainage systems and their use varies from region to region depending on climate and topography. Drainage problems can also haunt urban landscapes, compounded by the actions of developers and contractors, over irrigation, compaction, and other soil problems common to urban settings. We are speaking here of dealing with wet soils, not the engineering issue of removing stormwater out of yards. Often the easiest solution is the selection of plant materials suitable to the drainage. However, even wet-tolerant plant species are usually raised in nurseries with well-drained soils, and commercially available specimens may not have developed the adaptations they would have if grown in the wild in wet soils. One of the most dependable, attractive, and inexpensive surface drainage options is the landscape berm, a gentle mound raised by piling good soil atop the existing grade in an artistic fashion. Plants are installed on this berm, which raises roots above the drainage problem and which sheds water enough to maintain good aeration in the root zone. Berms should never be placed on the root system of existing trees. On a smaller scale, individual trees are often planted on their own slight mound to improve drainage around the root ball. A simple surface or subsurface system common to landscape settings is the French drain, a narrow ditch filled with gravel with or without drainage tubing in it. They are particularly useful for intercepting runoff or seepage from higher elevations. In conclusion, artificial drainage allows a grower to make a productive field out of soil that is too wet to grow crops. Drainage systems do have negative consequences, including losing wetlands, speeding the flow of water into swollen rivers, and transporting pollutants into rivers and other bodies of water.